In this era of globalization, Africa is still grappling with the high rate of unemployment, and Botswana is no exception. But do young people have enough strength and skills to swim against the tide? I have experts here who will deliberate on the issue. And all the way from Kenya, I have the renowned scholar, motivator, and lawyer of note, who is currently the director of Kenya School of Laws, Professor Patrick Lumumba, commonly referred to as PLO. Prof.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm happy to be in Gaborone here in
And
Botswana.
it's good to have you here.
Thank you.
And I also have Matlhogonolo Mponane, Deputy Chief Executive Director at Botswana Accountancy College, and is an individual who is passionate about talent development. Dumela, welcome to the program.
Dumela,
Yeah.
Rere Maroka.
Prof, it's good to have you here. And let us start it here. We have addressed graduates in a lot of countries, different gatherings, different issues, different disciplines. But what do you think of an African youth at the moment? What caliber of young people does Africa have?
First of all, let me say that Africa is at a crossroad, and the decision must be made, which route do we take? And I think there is a sense in which Africa has already chosen that route. Africa Agenda 2063, which is an initiative of the African Union, is in itself the underlying foundation against which Africans, and particularly young Africans, will build their futures. And these have been broken down in many countries in national visions. Here in Botswana, you have Vision 2036.
Yes.
And what I know is that governments are beginning to recognize that their economies, their politics, and social cohesion will be built on the backs of young men and women who are properly educated and who are inventors and innovators. The world is for those who innovate and those who invent.
I'm underlining the word properly educated.
Yes, properly educated. I
Not
think
just
that not
educated.
just, we've got to interrogate the kind of education
All
that we
right.
are handing down to our young men and women.
Yes.
Does it enable them to acquire skills which can be utilized for the benefit of their nation and for their benefit? If we have converted our institutions into certificate-issuing institutions, then the young men and women we are producing will not be beneficial to themselves and to their nations. And I think that every country must make the conscious decision to ensure that we interrogate what education we are handing down to those young men and women.
Based on what you have just said, what kind of a young person do we have? Do we have an educated young person? Do we have a skilled young person? Do we have a passionate young person?
I want to talk about the young man and young woman that we should have.
That we should have.
Yes, the young man
But
and woman that we should have is a passionate young man and woman, is a properly educated young man and woman, a person who has clarity of vision of what they want. Do we have such young men and women? There is a sense in which our education system in many African countries has not been producing such young men and women. But we should not lament about it.
But Prof, you are talking about the one we should have.
Yes.
What about the one we have?
The one we have very many good young men and
Okay.
women. I've walked across Africa and I have no doubt in my mind that we have a pool of young men and women. And even those who do not have the skills are teachable. This is
Okay.
Africa's teachable moment.
All right. Let me give it to you, Ma'am Ponang, the kind of young person that we have. You have heard what the professor says.
I think we have a young person that embodies and encapsulates the promise of the future. I think young people are very vibrant, and in interacting with young people, you know, because I run a coaching and mentoring program and I work for an educational institution, I find that we do have young men and women who are employable outside the parameters of this country. I think young people are very curious. Young people are very technologically enabled. And I think the kind of young man and woman in today's environment is somebody who is responsive to the kind of environment that we're in. And I think, you know, young people that are right now being educated are beginning to understand the need to have a global focus.
But do we have a young man or a young woman who can be entrusted with the future of this continent, with the future of this country?
You say it like you doubt it. We do.
No, I don't doubt it. I'm asking you. Do we have that caliber?
We you know what? We do. I think it's a two-pronged type response that I should give you.
Okay.
I think right now we have young men and women that are awakening to the fact that the world is fashioned in a particular way that they have to be responsive towards. And then we still have that young man or young woman who is still, because of, you know, let me just talk specifically about Botswana, which is a very patriarchal society or very patriarchal environment where the government of Botswana has for the longest time parented us as Botswana. I think we still do have, you know, maybe 25% of young people who are still waiting to be parented. But the great majority of young people that I interact with are going out there and doing things for themselves because the environment is shifting, you know, the ground is shifting beneath our feet.
Okay.
Let me just answer that question.
Chip in, Prof.
There is a sense in which for a very long time, young Africans have been made to believe that in order to realize your potential, you have to go to the United States of America, you have to go to Europe. But they are progressively realizing that in fact the opportunities are here because Europe and America are becoming hostile and you cannot realize your potential there. So it is incumbent upon us as people who have had the advantage of exposure to keep on reminding young men and women that this is the land of opportunity. Look at young Chinese who are coming here. Look at young Indians who are coming here. Why are they coming and we are going to lands where we will be literally enslaved? So there is a new awakening. Thomas Sankara of Burkina Faso said it very well, that if for Africa to grow, there must be a new African. And that requires, if one may, a character transplant of sorts. Self-esteem must be something that we embrace going forward so that we know we can do it.
Just to interrupt, just like what she said, can you confidently say, like she did, that Africa as a continent, we have a caliber of young people that we can entrust the future of this continent with them?
I can say that there are a few things. There is some panel beating to be done to these young men and women. First of all, they must believe in themselves.
Okay.
Secondly, they must have self-esteem. And thirdly, they must have a conviction that Africa is capable of carrying herself. In other words, we have the raw material, we have the rough diamond, now that I'm talking in a country that produces diamond, and our duty is to refine them so that they are ready for that market. It is our duty as a people to do that.
Okay. You wanted to add something?
Yes, I do. I also wanted to add on to what he's saying. I think, you know, what is also important is for us to develop a sense of Pan-Africanism. Thabo Mbeki's African Renaissance movement. I think it's very much important for us to have an awareness of the opportunities that are out here in Africa. I mean, a lot of people don't understand that right now in Rwanda, you know, there's a need for a certain set of skills that Botswana is actually producing. But you need people to go to Rwanda to go seek those opportunities. And when the professor was speaking about how young Chinese are coming to Botswana to seek opportunities or coming to the rest of Africa to seek opportunities.
If I may, you're talking about Rwanda. First of all, do these young people, are they aware of the opportunities in Rwanda? Secondly, are they willing? You are in Botswana, you stay in Botswana, you know Botswana. Do they know the opportunities and are they willing to go out to Rwanda to seize those opportunities?
Let me explain something to you, hey. The environment is such where if there is still a young person sitting somewhere who is not trying to interrogate opportunities outside, then that young person is still very much misguided. But that being said, I am aware that the government right now is actively encouraging young Botswana that are studying outside of Botswana to actually stay in the places where they are studying so that they can gain employment opportunities there. And for that matter, the young people that are here in Botswana, because it's unrealistic to expect that in terms of employment creation, that everybody is going to be employed within this country. Young people are being encouraged to go outside. So there needs to be, adding to what you're saying and maybe responding to what you're saying, it's very important for us to have a clear formulation of policy that is engineered towards educating young Botswana of the opportunities that lie outside the parameters of this country. It's very much also important that as we educate, and this is what we do at Botswana Accountancy College, we have professors and lecturers from all over Africa. So we do show young people that there is a whole world out there, and it is encouraged within our institution for young people to travel.
Prof, earlier on you said, you talked about properly educated.
Correct. Mm.
Do you think the education system as it is in Africa generally, is it failing young people?
There's a problem with our education system across the board. I have traveled and I'm familiar with the education systems of many African countries. And what has happened over the years is that we have acquired obsession with degrees, but we don't ask ourselves what is the content of the degrees that we are issuing. If you permit me,
yes.
Many African countries say that agriculture is the backbone of our economy. What a weak backbone it is in many African countries. If you go to the universities, what kind of things are they teaching their graduates of agriculture? If you look at a country such as China, for example, in the area of aquaculture, they are producing over a third of their fish from fish ponds. Are we doing that? If you look at a number of African countries, they are still importing poultry from countries such as Brazil. And I'm submitting to us that in every sector, whether it is in agriculture, whether it is in engineering, we must look at the content of what we are doing so that we are able to produce young men and women who are innovators and inventors, and we become manufacturers, and value addition becomes our forte.
If I may, you are saying, in other words, the way our education is must talk to our economic needs, must talk to what we say about our country. That's the example of agriculture.
Yes.
If at all agriculture is the backbone, then the education system must talk to this backbone.
You put it so well. That is what I'm saying. Because look at the education system that we inherited from the erstwhile colonizers. It was meant to produce Africans who would work as civil servants. And there is a large sense in which we have carried on that kind of education system without much interrogation. Mm-hmm. Going forward, we must ask ourselves at the University of Botswana, how many patents have you acquired in any given year in terms of creation, if it is food science technology? I was in an aircraft, which is an African airline. The butter is from Denmark. The wine is from France. How I wish that the butter...
African airline in Africa.
How I wish that the butter was from Botswana, that the beef was from Botswana, that the coffee was from Kenya, the cocoa was from Ghana or Cote d'Ivoire. Because when we talk about these things, it means that every sachet of sugar that I'm consuming, if it is produced in Zambia, it creates employment. And you ask the question which must be answered.
Yes, yes.
Do the young men and women in Botswana know about the opportunities in Rwanda? But before we go to Rwanda, within SADC, is there free movement of labor so that a young Botswana can cross over to Zimbabwe without need for a work permit, to Swaziland and Lesotho and vice versa? That is what we must do, so that these opportunities are made aware. In these days of social media, it is very easy for the African Union working through the regions to make Africans aware that there are opportunities in Nigeria, there are opportunities in different parts of the world, so that even the whole idea, xenophobia, comes in an environment of scarcity. Mm-hmm. When there is plenty, nobody is xenophobic. And I'm suggesting to you, you have a small population, a large country with natural resources, which are not forever, as we said earlier. Yes. Diamonds are not forever.
Yes.
So in which area are you going to be prominent? When I want to come for holiday, how developed is your tourism sector? How many visitors are you receiving in a year?
But just to chip in,
yes,
Prof.
Yes.
We have regional blocks, SADC, we have the one, the Eastern one, we have the ECOWAS, but do they provide opportunities to the member states for the citizenry of those member states?
If they don't,
or is just a shock?
If they don't, they should. In other words, and I say this almost...
But me and you know that they don't.
I agree with you. There is a sense in which they are not punching at their right weight. But there is a sense in which a number of things are beginning to happen. And I progressively I'm saying that in as much as we are acknowledging the failures, we must also begin to give prominence to the little successes and celebrate them. Is it possible today, for example, for a young person from Lesotho, Swaziland or Botswana to move into South Africa with greater ease than they did 10 years ago? If it is, that is to be celebrated. And what we should do is to ask ourselves, can we improve it?
All right.
And if we can improve it, then we work at improvement.
Thank you. Mamabona, you deal with graduates. And that, are they aware of the opportunities that they have in terms of being a member of SADC? And does SADC provide opportunities for young people of this country? Because we are talking about unemployment. There's a lot of unemployment amongst graduates, but we are members of SADC.
Can I just say, I'll get to that,
yes,
to respond to that.
Yes.
I can reliably inform you, Professor Lumumba, and yourself as well, that, you know, in Botswana, there's the Human Resource Development Council, and there's a very clear, speaking to your point, sectorial approach to how, you know, the government of Botswana has decided to look at which areas or which sectors we should be educating our young people. Tourism, as you spoke, is one such sector. Within the different sectors that are there, one should also emphasize the fact that there's a very deliberate and intent move on the part of the government of Botswana to actually equip the young people that are graduates today with a set of skills that will enable them to be employable anywhere, not just in Africa, but in the world. That being said, social media has, with great ease, enabled the spread of information and the spread of opportunities. If you get onto any Facebook wall, as an example, you will find that jobs are being advertised from as far as the African Union, jobs within different areas within other parts of Africa. But like the professor is saying, more of it can be done. I think the picture, as he was saying, sometimes we also need to give credit where credit is due. I think there's a need, though, to actively look at what has been done. But to answer your question, I think young people, by and large, are only now beginning to become awake to the opportunities that are out there, because the situation has gotten that bad to where you find people that have been sitting at home for the last 5 years.
But I guess even the regional blocks like SADC should open up.
Yes.
They should open up to these young people and allow them, and, you know, and reduce restrictions so that young people, there can be a flow of the workforce between the countries.
Absolutely. The integration of Africa and the need to also recognize, if we're saying, for example, if we're saying we are Botswana and we're saying we want to attract foreign direct investment, we should also make it enabling for people to come and do business in Botswana. We should also ensure that our policies speak to each other. If you're saying you want foreign direct investment, then there is a certain level of relaxation that you need to put to the fore in order for you to allow people to come here to create employment opportunities for Botswana and so forth.
Let me just say something. One of the things that has happened, and we don't speak about it as often as we should, I remember at one time the government of Seychelles deliberately came to the Kenyan government to provide them with teachers. I know now, for example, that Rwanda has asked the Ugandan government to give them over 1,500 English teachers. And I think that that is a good thing. We should see that happening in this region. We should see the government of Botswana collaborating initially within the region to see what it is that
I think
can do.
Just for your information, I think Botswana has been doing something with Namibia, if I remember very well.
Which is a very good thing.
Teachers,
and we should make noise about it. We make more noise about the wrong things, but we don't make noise about the right things. With the consequence, therefore, that we reinforce this kind of stereotype that Africans are prisoners of the artificial boundaries, they don't want to cooperate, they are xenophobic. But right now, I can tell you, Nigeria, for example, has introduced since last week a scheme where all Africans can obtain visas at the point
maybe,
of entry.
Maybe, Prof, we have lots of wrongs. That's why we're making a lot of noise about the wrongs, not the good. Maybe
I hear you.
But I think it's also worth noting that I think as Africans, we have to develop that sense of consciousness, that sense of black consciousness, going back to Steve Biko, where we have that awareness that, you know, the borders were carved in by Europeans somewhere in Europe back in, you know, the day. And we should not be given so much credence to those borders, because it was a slab of land, which was but a continent. And when you talk about the integration of Africa, it's really about harnessing the value that is here within Africa. I mean, in watching your videos, Prof, you often speak to the fact that there is so much natural resources. Africa is the wealthiest continent in the world. And I think it's important for us to start working actively to formulate policies that will enable us to harness that wealth.
And I want to note the media, just before you come in, the media must also liberate ourselves from this idea, dog bites man. Then that is not news. Man bites dog, that is news. So in my view, we've got to make deliberate effort on our part to say that while we take stock, it's like a balance sheet. We are doing well on this side, we are not doing well on this side, but the agenda for the African media is also to reinforce the positives and, of course, to critique
the wrongs.
You're
saying the media should deliberately go out to promote the positives.
That is what the European media does. That is what the American media does. Deliberately, you may hear the CNN talking about this and that.
Are you not being too harsh on the African media?
The African media has a greater duty now. It must be a developmental media without sacrificing the journalistic freedom. It must be developmental. Our own major media mogul, Hilary Ngweno, once said in 1980 that the African journalist is in a totally different place from his or her cousin in Europe and America. He is present in nations that are young and feeble. And he has a duty, in as much as they report the truth, to ensure that that truth is reported in a manner that builds rather than destroys. So that when father is dead, you don't come and say, your father has died. You said, slowly, we have had the sad news of the passing of your father. Mm-hmm. It is the same news delivered differently.
Yes, absolutely.
No, I understand. You want to chip in that
yes,
one?
Yes, I want to chip in.
Because
yes.
I wanted to leave that
no,
point.
No,
I want to chip in a bit.
Because it's so important for us to recognize that in selling our narrative, we're also selling who we are. You know, I read a very interesting article, by the way, which I will send to you by a journalist in Europe, who was saying that when you look at our media, and when you look at the reporting of this specific country, you would never want to come here, because you're going to think, I'm going to go there, the level of crime is very high, the level of corruption is at a high. It's reporting, yes, but I think we should not be sensational. I think when the prof said, you know, it's very important for journalists to have that ethical backbone of reporting the facts and being able, let me just finish, and being able to speak or whisper truth to power. But it's also very important that we are balanced. Because let me explain something to you. When you look at America and the way that America is rolling out its narrative, they talk about the American melting pot. They talk about the reality that anything is possible. There is so much patriotism behind that narrative that oftentimes people want to buy into, one could argue, maybe even the story, you know. And we need to be very careful without necessarily lying. I'm not saying we should lie, but we need to be very careful that we project ourselves and that our narrative, not only as Botswana, but as Africans, is enticing of the world to come here.
Probably Africa is doing more wrongs. That's why the media is into the negatives, not the positives.
I'm saying there needs to be a balance. Understand that the professor and myself, and I'm assuming the professor is in agreement with myself, but the professor and myself are saying
I wish you wouldn't agree with me.
No, we're very like-minded.
Right.
But it's important that we are seen as Africans to be presenting a balance of the reality and to be empirical in terms of our reporting. Investigative journalism is very important.
Thank you.
Yes.
Well, one quick one, Prof, before you go for break. Are you saying the media shouldn't talk about the wrongs that are evident in this continent?
Not at all.
When we're talking about minimizing, what are you saying?
No, I'm not saying
they should turn a blind eye.
I'm saying that the media has a duty to report the truth at all times.
Yeah.
But to do so without sacrificing the good that is happening. Look at what is happening now in many countries in the world. There is a new media called the CGTN, which is deliberately created by the Chinese to tell the Chinese story from a Chinese lens and prism, so that It is incumbent upon the media to tell us the truth as it is, but it's also important for them to tell us that there are good things that are happening. I know that the media, particularly because the philosophy of African media is also Western, is that the more sensational you are, the more attractive you are. But I'm saying that we can ensure that we speak the truth and also make us aware of the good things that are happening. For example, how many Motswana know that there is an electric railway line in Addis from Addis Ababa to Djibouti? There is one. How many Motswana here know that there is the Gauteng railway system in South Africa? Those are good things that we should celebrate. Okay. And if we do so, our self-esteem begins to grow and for us to believe that we are capable of achieving things.
Okay. But just before we take break, we talked about the universities and the graduates that we have, the kind of education system that we have. Mm-hmm. Every year, we have thousands and thousands of graduates and they are unemployment. Mm-hmm. They are unemployed. Mm-hmm. What is the solution to unemployment in our country and in Africa, especially looking at the kind of graduates that we have?
I think, like it has already been stated, there's a need for us to actively encourage young people to start seeking employment outside of Botswana. Because right now, Re Ramoroka, you do know where the government of Botswana is the hugest employer in this country. And when you talk about the government of Botswana, you're not just talking about the civil service, you're also talking about the parastatals, because parastatals are either formed by an act of parliament or parastatals are companies that are limited by guarantee. And most parastatals, if not all, are financed by government. So it is impossible and it is unrealistic. And this is the truth. And we should start acknowledging this for us to have an expectation as Botswana that all the graduates at some point are going to be employed within Botswana. And over and above that, there is need for us to clearly, and Prof, you and I had a conversation about this yesterday, to clearly start looking towards our middle class in terms of economic development, to actually engineer ourselves around making sure that we fuel the middle class, so that the middle class can bring out a crop of entrepreneurs who themselves can become employers of those people that are in the lower echelons of our society, that are also, by the way, their welfare is also being taken care of by the taxes that we pay. Okay. In terms of our developmental agenda. But I want to really also emphasize what Prof was saying, that it's important for us.
Can just sum your point up so that we can take a break?
So it's very important for us to look towards the integration of Africa so that the reality of Botswana going to other African countries becomes realized.
This one, Prof, after
yes.
this break.
Thank yes. you very much.
Yes.
We'll be back. Just stay tuned. We are just taking a quick break. Thank you. Thank you very much. If you just joined us, remember that we are tracking our unemployment, we are tracking skills development in Botswana and in Africa. Prof, solution to high unemployment rate in Africa.
You know,
Botswana included.
I honestly believe that there are two countries in Africa that can achieve 100% employment, Namibia and Botswana.
100% employment?
Yes, I believe so. Why do I believe so? These are countries with very small populations. I don't think the population of Namibia, the population of Botswana, and they are in a very useful place in terms of the resources that they are capable of harnessing. Look at the whole area of energy, which is an African problem. If Botswana were to make a deliberate effort to go into the solar or the green energy sector, mm-hmm. that would be an employment sector. Mm-hmm. If Botswana were to move in the direction, of course I know they are doing this in the diamond sector, but to deliberately say, jointly with Namibia and other SADC countries, we are going to be the Dubai of Africa in that sense, then unemployment would be eliminated or dramatically reduced. Has it happened in other countries? Yes, it has. Mauritius, the Mauritian model, where the Mauritians are simply saying, we are going to become the hub of investors. Seychelles, small but also comparable. Dubai or the Emirates, Qatar. And I'm saying that under your Vision 2036, let's be specific.
Yes.
One of the things that the government of Botswana must do is to deliberately identify areas of strength, and let us name them, the mining sector. We have already said that diamond is not forever. Mm-hmm. So we must plan as we go forward. What are we going to do in the mining sector that makes Botswana a magnet in the region? Because when you talk about magnet in the region, it means that you are talking about a population of nearly 300 million.
I just wish, yes, I can chip in there.
Please,
Prof.
Do.
Because we have thousands and thousands of unemployed graduates.
Yes.
The sectors we are talking about cannot absorb a lot of these unemployed graduates.
It is not going to be instant coffee solution. It is going to be progressive. And that is why your vision is 2036. Mm-hmm. Over a period of 20 years, if you make yourself a manufacturing hub, if you make yourselves a financial sector, if you make yourself the natural destination for tourism, I do not know how many tourists you are receiving now. If you are receiving anything between 2 million, if you were to receive 10 million, I'll give you an example. The Turkish town of Istanbul, their market receives 99 million visitors every year. Mm. If you are to increase that to 100 to 10 million in Botswana, that would absorb thousands. And not only employment, there is this obsession with wage monthly payment. Mm-hmm. I'm saying that young men should also be innovators and creators of employment, and that can be achieved. So that this lamentation in many African countries that governments must employ, governments are enablers,
okay,
and creators of environment.
I will definitely come back to that point, but I, yes, wish Mam Poran can come in here. But when we come in, I want you to respond to the professor's comment that Namibia and Botswana can achieve 100% employment. Do you think that's achievable? You are in Botswana, you are in Botswana, you know the numbers that we have here.
Every single time you interview me, I always smile because he poses the question like, you know, he already has the answer. Yes, yes. But an informed Doubting,
yes,
Thomas. I think what's really important is for us to look at the fact that he alludes to 2036,
yes,
you know, Vision,
yes,
2036, which is progressive. I do think, you know, and I agree with the professor when he says, over time, I think, realistically, if we are vibrant enough as Botswana, it can be achieved. Because if you think about it, the sun shines most of the year, if not 95% of the year in Botswana. So, you know, renewable energy sources is an area in which we can develop and in which we can find ourselves creating employment. The other thing that I find interesting that he mentioned is tourism. The tourism sector needs to be agile. The tourism sector needs to also slowly but surely go back into the hands of Botswana. Can I just say that? And when I say Botswana, I don't mean Botswana just working within the tourism sector, but we as Botswana need to be actively involved in the different models of tourism. But we have to be interested in traveling in our own country. Do you know, Prof, Botswana has the largest one of the largest masses of untouched land in the world, and that's the Delta. And a lot of Botswana have not been to see the Delta. I think, you know, you'll find Botswana in December going to places like Durban, going to places like South Africa. We all need to be proud of our narrative as Botswana, and I know there's brand Botswana. And that in itself is, you know, something that can also energize the tourism sector. But not forgetting as well, that even when you talk about mining within Botswana, it's very, very important that we start to realize that within the different programs, there's need for us as Botswana to take an interest in even the diamonds. We as Botswana don't know enough about the diamond industry. And I can see these days that
DBS... We have left it to the very few people.
Yes. I get it. You know, a person once said to me, and it's quite interesting, Prof, somebody once said to me, Botswana's economy relies on the vanity of Western women. And that is a reality. But we as Botswana need to understand how that diamond goes from being dug up, goes from being a rough stone to actually becoming
in other
a
words,
polished
if,
gem.
If I get you well, Mam Poran, you are saying Botswana has opportunities.
Yes, they are.
A lot of them are untouched.
Yes, I can say that. And a lot of them are untouched in large part because we as Botswana are also continuously not going out there to seek those opportunities and to actualize those opportunities for ourselves. Talk about knowledge production right now. A lot of Botswana have been educated. How are you educated and you're sitting at home and you've got 2 feet and you've got 2 hands and you can see, you've got sight, maybe not vision, but you've got sight. Mm-hmm. That sight needs to be translated, Prof, into vision.
Okay.
It's very, very important that we as Botswana need to start harnessing our own our own intellect and our own abilities to do things for ourselves.
Prof, you talk about innovation.
Yes.
You know, innovation is about money. Innovation is about funds. And we know the story in our African countries. In Botswana, it's the same story. I believe in Namibia, Lesotho, Swaziland, there are no funds to enable that innovation.
You know, it's an egg and chicken situation, as the cliche would go. Mm-hmm. But one of the things, if you allow me, is to look at how this problem can be resolved. Every country in SADC, let me start with the region, now has a national vision. Yours is Vision 2036.
Yes.
And the underlying philosophy is that by that time, Botswana will have achieved an acceptable level of development economically, socially, and politically. Politically, you are generally very stable. What must we do, therefore, in the region? In the region, we must realize that this youth dividend can only be earned if the youth are gainfully engaged. Remember, I'm using the word engaged rather than employed.
Okay.
And I'm saying, I know, for example, that the levels of unemployment in Zimbabwe are out of this world, 80%. South Africa has the same problem. One of the things that SADC should do is to require her members to have correct statistics of young men and women who are either unemployed or underemployed. And deliberate effort should be made to look at the sectors which are exploitable in each country and to require countries to report periodically, annually, on what they are doing about it. And that is why I'm saying you've got to look at all the sectors, both in the public and in the private, and ask yourself, what are the exclusive areas for public sector engagement? What are the areas of collaboration within the country? What are the private public sector areas? And what are the areas that can be dealt with regionally? And go to the universities. We must now require of the University of Botswana, the young men and women that you are producing, what are the set of skills that they are coming with into the market? Which brings me to the question that you posed,
yes, yes.
Money and resources.
That you are avoiding the
no,
pressure.
I'm not avoiding the resources.
Okay.
Money and resources can always be found if deliberate efforts are made. There is out there the African Development Bank, which is now engaging in very many infrastructural sectors. A country can make a deliberate decision that we are going to ask for money from the African Development Bank for the purpose of pioneering in areas of innovation, or not, if not pioneering, improving. You can go to multilateral institutions. We now have the BRICS Bank, which involves the countries such as Brazil, China, and South Africa, and get money from there. Private sector is another area that you can go to.
Let me get you well.
Yes.
Are you saying government should go out,
yes,
to get money, the money that will be specifically going to innovation?
Government and private sector.
And this private sector.
That is where you get,
yes,
the government to encourage private sector. And you can do it by telling private sector, you invest in this area, we are going to give you tax breaks. And if we give you tax breaks for 10 years on the understanding that the profits that you make are plowed into sectors that are going,
okay,
to improve agriculture and value addition.
I follow you, Prof. I want to bring in Mamponang to comment on what Prof said, especially looking at what we usually say in this country. Money, resources, and everything.
I think what Prof just described, by the way, is exactly the mandate of the Botswana International Trade Center.
Yes.
Because, you know, that is exactly the mandate where we are looking at attracting foreign direct investment. We are looking at re-energizing private sector participation in this country. And the avenues are there. The thing about, you know, the essence and the thing about everything is that you can have the best ideas in the world, but you need to implement them. And I think, you know, we need to actively now, as, you know, young Botswana, need to actively agitate towards the realization of all those models. The thing about Botswana is that we have some of the best policy documents in the world, and there is some implementation that's taking place, but we need to see more of that implementation. And I particularly like your point on private sector participation. I am not too sure though, Prof, and you can correct me there. I think even as we go out to borrow, we should watch out against certain policies that we know that have been in other parts of Africa, you can speak more on them, that have also been used to enslave African governments and to, in a sense, change the agenda of those countries from being enabling of that people.
If we don't borrow, what other solution do we have to funding?
Not necessarily borrowing. Look at the African Development Bank. And these are things that can't be dealt with at the SADC level and at the African Union level. The African countries can make a deliberate decision that out of the funds that are generated by the African Development Bank, 10 to 15% can go into innovation. And this is what was happening, for example, in the European Union. There were deliberate efforts that funds that are generated will go to universities to encourage innovation and inventions. And African countries must therefore contribute to the African Development Bank and African Union. Once this is done, let me tell you, this is a continent with massive resources. The idea that Africa does not have money is actually a fiction. The reality is...
It is a fiction.
Look at the Democratic Republic of Congo, for example, saying we don't have money to hold elections. How can they possibly say that? This is a country that has a scandal of resources. The resources in Congo are scandalous in terms of their volume and quantity.
I wish
and value.
Resources, what are you talking about, Prof?
I mean, look at it.
Break it down for me. Let
me tell you, just to veer off, just to demonstrate to you why we are sleeping on our laurels. Congo, it is every mobile phone that you have in the world has coltan, rare earth. Mm-hmm. The largest producer of that mineral is the Democratic Republic of Congo.
Absolutely.
If you look at the timber in that country, if you look at the possibilities for hydroelectricity, it is as if the gods conspired in heaven and said, Congo is going to be the residence of all resources. But you see, the divine instruction was go and subdue the earth. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we have allowed the earth to subdue us.
We are subdued.
So my own view is, if in the context, and Democratic Republic of Congo is a part of the SADC, if that were to be done and deliberate efforts were to be made, funds could be released through exploitation. And just give me a little latitude. Has it been done in our lifetime? China, in my lifetime, has moved from a backwater country into the second strongest economy in the world.
Absolutely.
China is too big, you will say. Chile, in my lifetime. Brazil, in my lifetime. Rwanda, since 1994, small, with a population of 11 million, genocide in 1994. Today you go to Rwanda and deliberate efforts are being made right now. Very simple things, saying every household will have a cow that produces milk. They have been done in Africa. In other words, it is doable in this continent.
Yes.
Look at your own livestock industry. You are exporting beef to Europe. Who tells you cannot satisfy the African market? You can. So that your problem will be demand, not supply.
And to speak
you can achieve that.
Okay.
And to speak
let's just allow her to comment.
And to, and to speak to your point, when you talk about Chile, for instance, that has been, Chile has grown economically and it's vibrant because of the Mercosur agreements. And it goes back to when you were talking about SADC and how we need to be delivered in that effort. And I smile when I look at you because Kenya also produces a lot of coffee, though Kenyans don't drink coffee. They drink tea. But I mean, Kenya produces a lot of coffee.
Okay.
Yes, I think I'm done there.
Thank you.
Yes.
Well, I just want to go back to the Prof, just one little one. You always quote from the scriptures.
Yes.
And I know, I think it's in Galatians, where the writer of the book says, Galatians, who has bewitched you?
Yeah.
If at all Africa has resources,
yes.
If at all Africa is not as poor as you are made to think, who has bewitched the continent there?
Well, we have
what's wrong with the continent?
First of all, it is the quality of men and women that we have entrusted with positions of leadership over time. Let me tell you, these things boil down on leadership at all levels. If you look at the history of the world, countries have realized their potential because they chose men and women who had conviction, had vision that we are going to move our countries in a particular direction. And permit me just to give a few examples.
Please
some
do.
Of them are very African. If you look at the early years of the independence movement fighters and the leaders, even here in your own country, in the short time that Sir Seretse Khama was the president, there was a sense in which he had vision. If you are familiar with the history of your own country, this was a country that had nothing. But a certain decision that were made, and you can go back to history and you say, yes, the first leader did something. In Ghana, when Kwame Nkrumah said, we are going to be an industrial country, let us build the Akosombo Dam. In Egypt, when Gamal Abdel Nasser said, we are going to build the Aswan High Dam. In other words, the leaders were clear very early on in those early days. In Zambia, Kaunda and the copper. In Tanzania and even in Kenya in those early days when we said agriculture is our backbone. So one is saying in a nutshell that when you have leaders who have vision, then you can realize your potential. Unfortunately, in the recent past, we have had men and women who think that they do not owe their countries anything. And we have had a bunch of kleptocrats, thieves, to call them by their proper name, presiding over African governments and selling our birthright to other civilizations. The net effect,
just one line, Prof.
Yes.
Do you think we can still make it right as a continent?
We have no choice. We must make it right. And the beauty of it is that Africans are now beginning
to realize.
And how long is
it going to take? It took us, you know, long. We destroyed everything. And how long is it going
can
to take?
Really
No. Don't be impatient. On average, the African country is just 50 years old. Some of these things may
thank
take
you.
Longer
thank
than
you.
We want.
Thank
it
you
may
very
take
much.
Centuries.
Thank you very much.
But the sooner the better.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
But Prof seems to be suggesting that Africa is not as poor as you are made to think.
No, I don't think it is.
You don't think
no,
so?
No, I don't think Africa is poor. I think in terms of fiscal management, you know, we must understand that we need to come up with robust policies. We must come up with, you know, and with intent, right? Mm-hmm. Real, implementable, basic and simple ways of achieving certain objectives. I mean, read the Vision 2036 document. It's a brilliant document.
Yes, I've gone through it.
And I'm very, very optimistic that it can be done because we're here. Ghana is on our laurels, Ramoroka.
Yes.
That people like yourself and myself, we are the future, you know, and we are the present as well. So those that are coming behind us should find a legacy. And I just want to chip into what you just said about leadership. I mean, Botswana right now, what you see is as a consequence of robust leadership. I was reading a very interesting article, and I've been speaking about this recently, by a Zambian journalist called Kalima Nkondo. I spoke about it yesterday on Duma FM, and he said that on the day that Ramasire passed away, may his soul rest in peace, I think it was on the 25th of June
yes.
this year, he says, Sir QKJ Masire, president of Botswana, past president of Botswana, passed away on the 25th of June, the year 2017, in Gaborone, in a hospital called Bokamoso Private Hospital in Botswana, not in Paris, not in London, not in Geneva, but in Botswana. That speaks to legacy. That is leadership. He built this country. He enabled that doctors were educated, infrastructure was put in place, to the extent that in his last moments, he chose to pass away in his own country.
That is
the stuff of leadership.
In other words, we are saying, as a country, Botswana, we should not be seeing ourselves as poor, as underdeveloped.
Yes.
We are able, we are capable,
yes.
We have the resources, and we can go further than what we have done.
Absolutely.
That's what you are saying.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's 100% what I'm saying. And I have that narrative and that belief about the rest of Africa, to the extent that I even have an African tattoo. It's the only tattoo I have, because I'm such a pan-Africanist. And I think young people are waking up to that realization and to that reality. I think young Botswana and young Africans, even if you look at social media, you look at the uprisings right now, the Arab Springs that happened a couple of years ago, that speaks to an agitation towards progress. And I see that there's quite an elevation of the mind and the spirit. And I think going forward, one needs to be very optimistic. I have a lot of hope.
I'm listening to you, Prof, and Mampone, I was like, do the African leaders, the educationists, everybody in leadership, do they think the way you are thinking and her?
If they don't think like that, it's our duty to make them think like that. And that is why we speak to leadership and speak to power with truth, with the firmness that will open their eyes. And I've seen quite a number of, wherever I go, in quite a number of countries, I'm engaging people in leadership at different levels. And I'm beginning to get convinced that these individuals now recognize that their own safety also requires that they begin to do the right thing.
Prof,
it's not going to be easy.
Something that you are too radical.
Yes.
maybe they wouldn't believe you that easy because they think you are too radical.
Not at all. In fact, I have interacted with quite a number of leaders at different areas, in different areas and in different sectors, and they hold the view that this is a message whose time has come. But beyond the rhetoric, they are now beginning to say, give us suggestions that are implementable so that we may cross-fertilize them. And that is our next level of engagement. We are telling government, this is what we must do. We now have a Pan-Africanist mentorship program in which we are also telling young people that you must not make demands of your countries and demands of your government without demonstrating what it is that you want to do to help your countries move in the right direction. So we are now at a different level. There was the level of simply speaking in the wild, in the wilderness, like John the Baptist. But there is now another level of going to the kings, if you permit me, like Nathan and David, and telling David in a manner that is polite and firm at once that there is something wrong in your kingdom, and the king then recognizes, I am the problem, and then resolve the problem in that way. We are moving in that direction.
You know,
yeah.
I love because you don't think you are radical. Yeah. Well, a lot of people, I've seen some analysis because they think you are too radical, but it's fine.
Yeah.
But, you know, the prophet is talking about it. I wish you can go back to the point that we earlier made, mm-hmm. that Botswana has skills.
Yes.
We have graduates
yes.
that are skilled.
Mm-hmm.
What are the skills that we have as a country that we can give out to other countries?
I think right now, look at skills and technology. Botswana has a lot of programmers. There are a lot of, right now, when you look at the development of apps, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you look at technology, do you know that some of the best, and I don't say this because I work for Botswana Accountancy College, but some of the best programmers are produced by the Botswana Accountancy College. There are a lot of IT professionals in Botswana. Those IT professionals are needed all over Africa, in places like Sudan, in the areas of Sudan that are safe and that one can enter into, in places like Rwanda, like I've already said. It's very much important for you to also recognize that there's active engagement with the government of Kenya, which is the technology hub of Africa, to actually see how we can collaborate and harness the skills that are there. There's also the Botswana Innovation Hub, which does a lot of work in terms of the enhancement and the harnessing of technology in order to create employment and to diversify our economy away from diamonds. I mean, there's a lot of wealth, and I am very, very optimistic.
Then you probably agree with Professor Lumumba that the onus is on you now
yes.
to make these young people
yes.
to know that that place is not here. That place is outside. It's
absolutely.
It's in Sudan. It's in Lesotho. It's in
absolutely.
Namibia.
Absolutely.
It's in Congo.
Absolutely. It's all over the world.
It's all over the world.
Yes.
Let me make this point. Part of the problem that we have in Africa is our fidelity to these artificial boundaries.
Yes.
You know, if you look at the United States of America, a young man or a young woman in Boston, Massachusetts, without any border, without anything, moves to Seattle in Washington, 6 hours. But here, you move from Gaborone here and you go to Luanda in Angola. Somebody is asking you for a visa. Somebody is asking you, for, you have a different currency to deal with.
Just you're, Angola.
Just Angola here. After 50 minutes flight. Mm. My own view is that we must now deconstruct these artificial boundaries.
Mm.
We must now tell our leaders that these boundaries were created by the colonialists in 1884. We will respect them because they give us the ability to control and to deal with security. But in terms of movement of labor and movement of workforces and movement on tariff and non-tariff barriers, we are going to ignore them.
Yeah.
We are going to allow our young men and women to move from Gaborone to Dakar in Senegal and seek employment there. When we do that, let me tell you, this unemployment thing will be reduced so dramatically, you'll be amazed.
We are borrowing heavily from the scriptures.
Yes.
And we know very well that when God created the earth and the heavens, he said, let there be. And you are just saying, let there be free movement
Absolutely.
Of the workforce.
Once we deal with security, once we deal with all other things, why shouldn't I just take a bus
because
from Gaborone and go to Lusaka?
Okay. Because the chaos, if you look at it, I mean, the colonial masters were smart in that they understood that the chaos would be ensured if you keep us disenfranchised from each other, if you keep us disintegrated. And when you, what he's describing is simply a way of us harnessing the different elements and the skills that are required to actually turn the slab, which is a continent, into something that is quite impressive. And the Asians have been able to do that. You have to also understand going back to you, Prof, that you really cannot break down the master's house with the master's tools. So there is need for us to start looking at African solutions for Africa.
Absolutely.
And there is need for us to start developing that narrative and to become architects of that narrative ourselves and not leave it to the next person to do for us. Yes.
I know there's something that you have said about Botswana, but I want to go back to that because Botswana is predominantly mining. It's about diamonds. And then there in second, maybe tourism and maybe agriculture came in there. And what do you think Botswana should do in terms of education and bringing up graduates so that they can address opportunities that are provided by these other sectors apart from mining?
I think this should be a deliberate effort, and I think there is a sense in which in your Vision 2036 the government is beginning to realize that these are not inexhaustible resources and that therefore progressively we should begin to move in other sectors. And that is where collaboration between institutions of higher learning with policymakers becomes very critical. The university should have seats in critical sectors of government to ensure that going forward, 10 years, 20 years, which are the sectors that we can open? If it is agriculture, what area in agriculture that we have the competitive edge and advantage? If it is in the area of mining, what are we going to do that we improve mining beyond simply digging up diamond from the ground? If it is in the area of finance, are we going to be a financial hub that is going to compete with Johannesburg and Durban? If it is in the area of energy, green energy, what are we going to do to ensure that we are the leaders in solar energy? We are the leaders in all these other sectors. So I believe that there are those new areas that we can begin to look at and to look at them deliberately, and resources must be employed and deployed and employed in those areas. Okay. The universities, and this is one of the things that I'm going to say, the typical African university is still an ivory tower. That must stop happening. And which countries can you borrow from? South Korea. Collaboration between industry and universities. Germany is another country. The Scandinavian countries that we don't all talk about as often as we do, Norway, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, what are they doing?
Okay.
They are doing this in a deliberate manner, and they are constantly re-examining their education system and asking the fundamental question: the graduate that we produce, is he or she capable of carrying her weight anywhere in the world?
Probably we are at a time, Prof, where the industry should dictate to the education system.
I have nothing more to add to what you have said. You are so right that I would spoil it by adding.
All right.
Yes.